This morning I'll be reading from Galatians 5, 1, 13 through 25 of the NRSV. For freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by another. Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, to prevent you from doing what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Now, the works of the flesh are obvious: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, immorality, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. I am warning you, as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, and faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. May God bless the reading of His word.
Let us pray. Sovereign God, ruler of all hearts, you call us to obey you, and you favor us with true freedom. We ask that you keep us faithful to the ways of your Son, that leaving behind all that hinders us, we may steadfastly follow your paths through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. You may be seated. When we came to our prayer time, I also want to keep in prayer our friends and our neighbors who may be without air conditioning. Please make sure to check on your elderly neighbors and those that may not have fans or air conditioning. Offer to bring them over some water or a fan or something like that. Let us take care of one another as God calls us to do so. I'm a history professor. I love history. I debated in my life whether I wanted to be a history teacher, but God had other plans. One of my favorite parts of history is I love Civil War history. I devour any book on the Civil War. And one of my favorite presidents that I like to study is President Abraham Lincoln. And one of these quotes that Abraham Lincoln said that I just love, it's one of my favorite quotes. Have you ever heard this? He was asked, whose side has God gone in the Civil War? And he responded, "Sir, my concern is not whether God is on our side. My greatest concern is to be on God's side. God's side is always right." How about that? I love that quote. As we approach our nation's birthday, Independence Day, the key celebration theme is freedom and God's presence in our lives. Often we think about our freedom that came about after wanting freedom, fighting for our freedom, and yes, many willing to give their lives for freedom. We talked about Abraham Lincoln and this quote. And as we think about different wars, each side thought God was on their side. How do you determine whose side God is on? And this is where Abraham Lincoln said, "Don't worry about God being on our side. Are we on God's side? Are we doing what we're called as God's people, as God's servants, as God's created people?" In my office at home, there hangs a picture of a Catholic priest And it's one of my favorite pictures. And this, if you can see this, this is Father William Corby. Let me give a little background about this. Tomorrow, July 1st. Wow, where did June go? July 1st was the beginning of the Battle of Gettysburg. And it went through the 4th of July. Can you imagine the major carnage that happened on the 4th of July in Gettysburg, the day of our freedom that we celebrated the 4th of July? Well, this is Father William Corby. And what's happening is, you can't see it, but there's bullets whizzing around the air. And Father Corby is standing on a rock in front of the Union troops. And these young men are about ready to go fight. The injured, maimed, many of them will die. And they sought out God's protection, God's forgiveness. And what we see here is Father Corby is giving them his blessing before they go out in the field. And Father Corby is telling them, whatever happens now, you are sealed in God. Now, what you don't see in this picture is on the other side of the field, there was probably the same thing going on. There was a Confederate chaplain blessing Confederate troops and telling them the same thing. Whose side is God on? We need to be on God's side. Now, here's our history lesson for today. Father William Corby, and what's funny, Civil War chaplains, you know what Father Corby got as a Union chaplain? A horse, a saddle, and a tent. There you go, go out and do good works. But after his Union service, Father Corby became the head of a small university called the University of Notre Dame. You ever heard it? So, thanks be to God for Father William Corby. He's one of my heroes. Great pastor and great chaplain. We talk about war. We talk about the freedoms of this country that we have been willing to fight. We've been willing to die for our freedom to be citizens of this great country. If anybody's ever studied history, there's such a thing called as the just war theory. And what it means is this was developed by man. How do we know if a war that we're involved is something that God wants us to be involved in? Well, a moral defense of war. So if we're going to fight in a battle, it has to be for a moral good. And then developed by Christians in the 5th century to balance the beliefs of Christianity with the need to go to war. A system to justify the use of force, and principles to include just cause, competent authority, right intention, last resort, probability of success in proportion. We try to make war ethical. And for us, many Christians, if we're going to fight for our freedoms, we try to follow these rules. The just war theory. The purpose of this doctrine is to ensure that war is justifiable through a series of criteria, all which must be considered before going to war is considered. We do know that many soldiers on many sides and many different battles and wars go to God to empty their hearts and to share their fears before the one true God. They know that they must go to God and place the outcome of the day into his hands. The one thing that all of these soldiers had that day of Gettysburg and in most wars was the freedom in Christ to gather in his presence. So what does this have to do with our text from Galatians? Let's have a little history lesson of the book of Galatians, Paul's work in Galatia. So Paul had been to Galatia, and he had taught about what we're supposed to do and how we're supposed to act after the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So Paul goes on his way, he continues his travels, What happens after Paul leaves? They have some false teachers come into Galatia and they say, he didn't know what he was talking about. You all need to follow the Old Testament rules and go back to sacrificing animals, to go back to the Old Testament rules. So Paul makes another trip back to Galatia and he says, you have been taught incorrectly. You didn't hear what I said the first time. You need to love others as Christ loves you. And in regards to the Old Testament laws and ways, if you are still consider yourself a Hebrew, that's what you must do. But if you consider yourself a person of Christ, Christ is a new thing. And this is how we act. So that's our little Galatian history lesson. But we want to talk about the two differences this morning between national freedom and freedom in Christ. And we must understand that our religious freedom is no good when we are apart from God. So if we were to go back to that picture in Gettysburg, those soldiers knew that. They were afraid, and where did they go? They went into God's presence, and they knew that if they died that day, if they were maimed that day, they did not want to be apart from God. They needed their religious freedom so they could go fight for their country's freedom. You see how both work hand in hand. Today's text from Galatians speaks to the freedom that we all have as his people, to go into his presence. And as we celebrate the freedoms as United States citizens and as Christians, we must understand that our religious freedom is no good when we are apart from God. And when are we apart from God? When is the time that God can't come and get us? It's when we turn our back on God. Could you imagine me as your pastor if I preached here with my back towards you, and I talk to the wall? Would you feel like you were present with me? When you face God and look upon God, you are in his presence, and you accept his invitation to come into his presence. And these soldiers that fought for our freedom understood that they must be in the presence of God before they go off and fight for their country. Here's the difference. When we think about our freedoms as citizens of the United States, we've talked about those that have gone off and fought and died for our freedom that we have today. And thanks be to God for that. But let's talk about our religious freedom. We don't have to fight for it. We do not have to die for it. Because there was a man 2,000 years ago on a cross on a hill called Calvary that died for our eternal life. And he took his sins upon himself. Here's the difference between Christianity and a lot of other world religions. You need to fight and die. In Christianity, Jesus Christ calls you for him. He doesn't say, give me your life. He says, I gave my life for you. Now live for me and tell others about me, my son, what he's done for you. Religious freedom. Religious freedom in Christ is one that Christ supplied. He died for it. This freedom was as I told the earlier service this morning, I can fill this sanctuary with the past, but I need your help. Can you do this for me? Next Sunday before church, would you go tackle people and handcuff them and bring them forcibly in here? Right? It doesn't work. An invitation for people to be in worship, you've got to want to be here. You've got to say, I need to be there. I've got to be there. Cannot force anybody to do anything that they don't want to do. What's Phil saying? You can take a horse to water, but you can't make him drink?
Right.
Right. Well, you can handcuff somebody and bring him into church, but you can't make him worship. Invitation. And this is what God supplies us this morning, friends. An invitation. He has not forced you to do a thing. He lets you choose to love him, to receive him, to make him part of your life. I like to think of it this way. We talked about the Heaven Dictionary. There's nothing negative in the Heaven Dictionary. We know that our freedom in Christ does not give us permission to do whatever we want as followers of Christ. Paul tells us that our freedom in Christ Jesus is an invitation to be what we could not be otherwise. Here, listen to this. To be what we could not be otherwise. Now, you'll hear pastors all over the world saying this right now. Well, y'all, you need to get out of your comfort. What is that pastor saying? You need to be what God has created you to be. And you know what? You need to accept that invitation and to go out and trust. When we have this freedom in Christ, we are not forced, but rather we are guided by the Holy Spirit to a different kind of life. One marked by the fruits of the Spirit. These fruits are goals of life and freedom in Christ and an invitation for us to share. These are great words. Write them down if you want to. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And when I do this sermon again, I'm going to use a different image because this morning I couldn't read it and said, God wants me to have a yellow banana. I couldn't read that this morning. These are the fruits of the Spirit that we are free and invited by God to offer to others. Beloved, we embrace and celebrate our freedom as citizens of the United States. But let us understand the differences. Write down these two dates. 1776 and 33 A.D. In 1776, we won our freedom to be our own country with our victory over the British. And with this, we had the freedom to develop what? The Constitution and the Bill of Rights in how we choose to live our lives. What's funny is many of you know my mom was born in Ireland and raised in England. I still had aunts and cousins in England. And probably this week, I'm going to get a message from one of them and said, how are you Yanks going across the pond since you left? So they still call us Yanks, and they call that ocean the pond. And I said, we're doing fine across. In 33 AD, a man by the name of Jesus, who was both human and divine, was hung on a cross on a hill called Golgotha, which means the hill of the skull. Otherwise known as hell. On this cross, Jesus Christ died for our eternal freedom and forgiveness of our sins. He paid with his life for our redemption and our eternity. My friends, Paul is pointing out the differences in freedom or self-freedom in Christ when he states that human freedom is focused on the survival of the self and freedom is based on Christ. You see, worldly freedom is based on the self. What's in it for me? And freedom is in Christ. It's what's in it for all of us? What has Christ done for all of us? For the weak. Holy Spirit, the power that he gave us, that God made available through the risen Christ. You see, when we're selves to the world, we're by ourselves. When we're free in Christ, we have the Holy Spirit with us. Every day we live and breathe, and we're never alone. celebrate the 4th of July with fireworks, cookouts, parades, and Thanksgiving for the country that we live in. Let us also celebrate our freedom in Christ by remembering when we entered into the waters of our own baptisms to follow Christ, when our lives were radically changed from self-attitudes that value and nurture the world that God created, which Jesus lived, died, arose, and is coming back for. Yes, feel empowered as citizens of the United States, but also make sure to feel empowered through the Spirit of a risen Christ. Yes, churches all over the world fulfill the sanctuaries of the world, but you can't force it. You've got to be like Jesus Christ. You need to extend an invitation. You need to invite. You need to welcome. You need to go out of your comfort zones and say, hey, I go to a really nice church. Would you like to go? And the worst thing that our church is going to do for you is they're going to love you in the name of Jesus Christ. I can think of worse things to have to endure. A church that will love you is a blessing through the freedom of Jesus Christ. Beloved, you have freedom of national independence and freedom in Christ. Enjoy this week, and as you embrace our country, make sure to embrace, thank, celebrate, praise, and worship the freedoms that we have.